This book is an airing out of a lot of things, but you come across as less guarded. Is that hard for you? Does it feel good to do it?
It really does, Anderson. I write in the book about how, you know, for so much of my time in public life, I felt like I was on this high wire with no net. I was trying to balance so many different competing concerns. And I wanted to write a book that would be as candid, take people behind the scenes as I possibly could, share some of what went on the road, the kinds of activities that you do when you're running for president, especially as a woman, but also to tackle the hard questions, like what happened in the campaign, what were the mistakes I made, which I, you know, talk about, and what else happened, and particularly with an eye to understanding what we need to know so it doesn't happen again.
One of the things you write about is the inauguration.
Yes.
I want to just take you back to Inauguration Day. You're standing inside the Capitol, waiting to go out on the platform with former President Clinton. What was going through your mind?
Well, it was such a surreal moment because usually a candidate who doesn't win the election without some other position wouldn't go.
Right.
But as a former First Lady, you know, my husband and I go to inaugurations. It's part of the way we demonstrate continuity of government. And I really debated whether I could do it or not. And
you actually called up Jimmy Carter, former President Carter,
yes.
And George W. Bush.
Right. Our offices were in communication with both the Carters and both Bushes, and the elder Bushes couldn't come because of ill health. But, you know, both George and Laura and Jimmy and Rosalind were going to go, and Bill and I just said, you know, we got to do this. So we were going, but I can't tell you I was looking forward to it. And as we were standing inside the door of the Capitol before you descend the steps to go out to the platform, you know, I was just thinking of what it was like when Bill won and what it was like when I was there in 2001. I was a newly elected senator, but Vice President Gore had lost, and coming back when President Obama was inaugurated, there were so many memories running through, you know, my mind, and I did not know what to expect. And I write in the book about how really strange it was to sit there and to listen to the kind of speech that was so divisive. The rhetoric was hot. I call it a cry from the white nationalist gut. Instead of taking the moment to say, you know what, I want to reach out and be the president for everybody. You know, he didn't win the popular vote. He squeaked through in the Electoral College. He had a chance to really begin to fill the role, and that didn't happen that day.
You talked about American carnage.
Yes,
that surprised you.
Yes.
When you were standing the steps, you write in the book that you were wishing you were anywhere else but there.
Anywhere else, Bali maybe. You know, anywhere else.
Do you regret not going to Bali instead?
No, I am afflicted with the responsibility gene. I did the right thing. I knew I had to go, but I have to quickly add that the next day was great. You know, the Women's March filled with enthusiasm and nearly 5 million people, biggest ever in our history, really lifted my spirits.
You also write in the book that George W. Bush reportedly said after the inauguration, that was some weird shit.
Yes. And I said I couldn't have agreed more.
you agree with that sentiment?
I do. It was so strange. I mean,
will you reveal your sourcing on that? is she sitting across from me right now?
Well, no. I phrased it very delicately.
I know that.
You know, it was. I went to the lunch afterwards. I mean, I did everything that you're supposed to do. I went to the lunch.
You also said you spent a lot of time on the platform avoiding eye contact with people who had been cruel to you.
Yeah, well,
and said terrible things.
Yes, I mean, I was obviously aware that there were a lot of people there who had said terrible things about me. You know, I could hear some locker up chants in the distance. And then on the way out, I ran into one of the, you know, people in the Congress who'd been pursuing me. I didn't recognize him, to be honest.
You're talking about Jason Chaffetz.
I am. I thought it was Ryan Priebus. And
you thought Jason Chaffetz was Ryan
Priebus? Yes, I was leaving the platform, and, you know, this gentleman stuck out his hand, and, you know, I greeted him, and I thought it was Ryan Priebus.
He tweeted out a photo, in fact, and he said, I want to get it right, he tweeted out a picture saying, "So pleased she is not the president."
Yeah, and I said I would have liked to have said yeah, and I thought you were Reince Priebus. But anyway,
you called him a wannabe Javert.
I did call him a wannabe Javert.
Are you a big Les Mis fan?
I am a huge Les Mis fan. Who isn't that, you know, that's ever seen it or heard the music?
Does that happen to you a lot? I mean, people coming up to you who have said terrible things about you, not to your face, and then being very friendly to your face. I mean, after the luncheon, A congressman came up to you.
That's right.
Who had called you, I think, the Antichrist.
Did, called me the Antichrist, and came up to introduce his wife to me. I'd never met him before. He's now our interior secretary, as I write in the book, and he could not have been nicer in coming up to say hello, wanting to greet me. And I said, well, you know, Congressman, I'm not the Antichrist. And he immediately backpedaled, and oh my goodness, and his wife could not have been nicer. But I make the point that when you are subjected to the kind of abuse that we see much too much of in our politics right now, both in person and online, and people feel very free anonymously to say terrible things or from a long distance where they don't have to look you in the eye, they don't have to relate to you or try to figure out, you know, where you stand on something, why you believe what you believe. And it's a real loss. It's a loss. I mean, this hyper-partisanship and this negativity that I think has been, you know, really inflamed by the internet, I've given a lot of thought to it over the last months.
You also have a lot of people since then, since Inauguration Day in the last 8 months, coming up to you, women coming up to you with their daughters and saying, my daughter didn't go out to vote, and sort of wanting absolution from
me. Right. That happened to me. What's more common are people bursting into tears, welling up. I had a lot of that at my book signing yesterday here.
Do you give absolution to those who didn't vote, to women who didn't vote?
No, I don't. I when it first started happening, it was so soon after the election, and the election was so bizarre and close. It was hard for me to, you know, comfort somebody who was coming to me and saying, oh, I wish I'd done more, or I'm sorry I didn't vote, because I think this was one of the most consequential elections that, you know, we have faced in a long time. So no absolution, but of course, you know, I just hope people will take what happened this time seriously and be ready and willing to vote the next time.
It seems like you've been doing a lot of yoga.
Yes, and alternate nostril breathing.
Well, I wanted
to ask
you.
Have you tried that?
Page 27 in your book, you talk about alternate nostril breathing.
Yes.
What is that? And dare you give me a demonstration
of
that?
Well, I would highly recommend it.
Okay.
You know, I mean, you're supposed to shut your eyes. I don't want to shut my eyes on national television. But, you know, you do hold and you breathe through one and you hold it and then you exhale through the other and you keep going. I can only say, based on my personal experience, that if you're sitting cross-legged on the yoga mat and you're doing it and you're really trying to inhale and hold it and then have a long exhale, it is very relaxing. So I don't know if you can do it in the middle of hurricane coverage, but maybe some other moments you can try it. I found it quite helpful.
I wanted to talk to you about Jim Comey.
Yes.
When Comey said that he was reopening the investigation, you believe that is the day that effectively your campaign was over?
Well,
that you lost?
I believe, based on a lot of evidence and a lot of assessments by other good analysts, Nate Silver being one, that yes, that was the determinative day because it stopped my momentum. I don't blame voters for wondering what the heck was going on. You have the FBI director saying what he said. And it was a, you know, terrible time to try to break through the last days of a campaign when you had this hanging over my head and it wasn't really lifted until the Sunday before the election and you had people early voting believing that, oh my gosh, there really is something here. I knew there wasn't. And I knew that it was hard to understand why he didn't just call me and others up and say, hey, can we look at this?
You feel you had been making progress winning back white women voters?
I believe, well, I'll give you one quick example that I write about. Not my polling, but other polling. I was leading about 26 points in the Philadelphia suburbs. That could not have happened if I hadn't had a lot of women and a lot of Republican women, independent women, saying that they were going to vote for me, telling pollsters that. I won those suburbs by 13 points. That's a huge loss, and I needed to win by probably about 18 to counterbalance what happens in the rest of the state, which is something that we all knew going in. But, you know, I talk about this in the book because I do want to answer questions that people might have. But what I think is important is to really take a candid, hard look about, you know, what the factors were. I hope nobody ever faces what I faced with respect to that, but whoever runs again, probably starting in 2018, will face Russian interference, may face coordination between opposition campaigns and Russians, will face voter suppression, will face endemic sexism and misogyny. And part of why I wrote this book was not only to come to grips with what I think happened, but to send up some, you know, alarm signals so that others can say, hey, wait a minute, these factors could affect anybody, and eventually Republicans could be affected.
Some of your critics, when they hear you talk about misogyny, they say, they roll their eyes and say, look, that's an excuse. That in this day and age, we had an African-American president.
But there's a big difference between what motivates voters on race and what doesn't motivate voters on gender. Most people in my position who have run for office, particularly at the state level for senator, governor, and certainly my experience is running for president, you don't like to raise this because you don't want people to think, hey, you know, you're making excuses. But I decided to raise it. I write a whole chapter about it because I think if we don't confront it, especially given the words and actions of our current president, it could be a big backlash that will undermine a lot of young women and their own futures. And now we know it's not just in politics, it's in Silicon Valley, it's in businesses of all kinds.
You talked to Sheryl Sandberg, and,
yes.
And you believe that there's a double standard, that women who, when you were Secretary of State and you were seen as working for somebody else's interest, the United States' interests, you were very popular. Polls showed you were not
69% at the end of my tenure.
But that when you were seen as working for yourself as a candidate, there's a different viewpoint.
And Anderson, it's not just what I believe. As you mentioned, Sheryl Sandberg, who's just delved into all the research that we possibly have about these issues. When a man is professionally successful, he is seen as more likable. As a woman becomes more professionally successful, she is seen as less likable. As you point out, when a woman advocates for someone else, in my position as Secretary of State, for my country, for the president I was serving, you know, people can really like you, like the job you're doing. I'm the exact same person. And then all of a sudden, I step into the arena. It's true even with something as mundane as if a woman goes to her employer and advocates a raise for someone else, she's seen as a great team player, leadership, and all the rest. If she goes and advocates for herself, it counts against her. Whereas if a man goes and advocates for himself, hey, you know, the guy's got guts, he's willing to step up and ask for what he wants.
You said about Jim Comey that he shivved you.
Yes.
Which is a very, I mean, that's a strong word.
It is a strong word.
And it also implies that this was personal or that he was trying to get you.
He's never been clear about his motivation, and what bothered me the most as the time went on after the election is, and we learned more about the open FBI investigation into the Trump campaign and their connections with Russia. That had been going on for quite some time. The American people didn't know about it. He was specifically asked, why didn't you tell the American people about that investigation? And he said, well, because it was too close to an election. So ask yourself, a closed investigation that ended the prior July, an ongoing investigation into the Trump campaign and Russia, one deserves to be blown out of all proportion, nothing to be found one more time, and the American people don't have the information that there's a legitimate investigation going on about Trump and Russia before they vote.
Do you think it is personal?
I have no idea. I can't sit here and tell you. I know that there had to be some pressure on him because Rudy Giuliani announced 2 days before that letter came out that something big was coming in 2 days. And people have speculated, was he under pressure from Giuliani and others within the FBI or the broader law enforcement community? I don't speculate on it. I just talk about how really hard to understand it was and the impact that it had.
One of the things, though, that Director Comey gave for that press conference in July was the meeting that your husband had on the tarmac with the Attorney General Lynch. You write about it in the book, but what you don't mention in the book is what you said to your husband when you heard about that meeting.
I didn't hear about it for days because it was so inconsequential to both of them. And then when I heard about it, I didn't really think much of it. And I think this was a rationalization that was used for being able to do what he did. But you know, what's important to me going forward is, as I say, I think it's important to focus on what happened because lessons can be learned. But the more important lessons that will affect our democracy going forward are not about him and his investigation. He, I think, forever changed history, but that's in the past. What's important is the fact that the Russians are still going at us. He himself admitted that before Congress. People I really respect, like Jim Clapper and John Brennan and others who knew what the Russians were doing, have been sounding the alarm. I will tell you this, Anderson, if I had been elected president under the same circumstances so that, you know, I lost the popular vote, I squeaked through the Electoral College, and evidence came up that the Russians, for whatever reason, were trying to help me, I would have said on the first day in office, we're going to launch the most thorough investigation. No nation, particularly an adversary nation, can mess with our democracy. I would have had an independent commission. I would have done everything I could to get to the bottom of it because it's not going to stop. That's what I'm worried about.
In USA Today,
and the special counsel. I don't know what he's going to end up with. He's a very honorable man. If there's nothing there, there's nothing there. If there is, I think he'll tell us. Put that to one side because that's ongoing. It almost doesn't matter. Our president, whoever our president is, should be defending our country and should be standing up and saying, nobody messes with America. We are not going to tolerate that. We don't hear any of that coming from the White House.
Because of Russia's role, do you think there should be an asterisk next to President Trump's name in the history books?
Look, I don't know. We don't know. We don't have all the facts yet. What I believe we now know, they paid for Facebook ads, and those were disseminated broadly. We know that they had access to targeting and data information from somewhere, maybe internally, maybe help externally. We know that they had Russians pretending to be Americans who were online and in person trying to foment negative stories about me and positive ones about Trump. We know there was a huge amount of content being produced in places like Macedonia. We know that WikiLeaks, which is basically a front now for Putin, was more than willing to publish stolen emails from the DNC, from John Podesta, and that then those emails were weaponized with ridiculous, absurd, untrue stories being churned out, on and on. So there's a lot we know already.
You follow this extremely closely.
Well, I started following this back in the summer of 2016 because there was something going on. When the DNC hack happened, you know, we had a huge political crisis when Republicans physically broke in to the Democratic Party's records back in the so-called Watergate years. This is a different kind of theft, and it's—
Do you think this is bigger than Watergate?
I think it's probably bigger than Watergate because it is about the future. You know, we no longer are worried about, you know, spies and provocateurs with, you know, dressed in black with gloves breaking into an office and stealing information. They do it sitting in the offices of the Russian, you know, military intelligence and other related venues, and they get into what is the core of our life now through the computers networks.
As you know, though, Republicans will say no vote was ever changed. This did not affect the outcome
of
the election.
I would say two things. This was a highly sophisticated influence operation. I believe it did affect people's votes.
You think it cost you votes?
I think it cost me votes.
The fact that those emails were dumped, those emails were
released. And that they were weaponized. So in the book, I write about how if you go look at Google searches, particularly in some of the battleground states during October, and you listen to Trump's speeches where he mentioned WikiLeaks, I think 160 times, they clearly knew that stories that were making stuff up, trying to use the emails, were permeating Facebook and other sites. The worst of them was this Pizzagate story, where, honest to goodness, out of whole cloth, made up, They took the word pizza out of one of John Podesta's emails and said that he and I were running a child trafficking ring in a poor little pizza parlor in Washington. It sounds absurd. Millions of people were exposed to that. The horrible hit job, total lies about the Clinton Foundation, people were affected by that because we could see that the WikiLeaks searches in a lot of places that were historically kind of swing counties were really rising. I think the influence did affect individual voters. What we don't know yet, and we're only beginning to get evidence of, is why were the Russians intruding into our voter registration rolls?
But you think this Russian interference was not enough to have cost the election if Director Comey hadn't reopened that investigation?
That's what I believe. I believe, though, it became a perfect storm. Reopening it, which caused people once again to be obsessed with emails, and then Podesta's emails being used to drive all this negative story about me. I think it came together to really kind of make some people queasy. Like, oh my gosh, what if she goes to jail? I heard that so many times. I've talked to reporters who were out there covering the campaign to the very end, and people would say things like, you know, I like her and I think she's done a good job, but what if she's in jail? And, you know, I knew that that was happening, but I thought we would ride it out.
I want to ask you about the second debate, which took place 2 days
after. And you were there, and I want to thank you. I want to thank you, Anderson. I'm hard on the press, as you know from reading the book in many ways, but a couple of people come in for, you know, good descriptions and praise. And I thought the way you started that debate, what you said in the beginning needed to be said, and I really appreciated that.
Well, what you're referencing is my first question to President Trump, which was, you know, describing what he had talked about. He described it as locker room banter, and mm-hmm. I said, that is sexual assault, or do you understand that? We wrestled, as a co-moderator, we wrestled with how to handle the Access Hollywood tape. I'm wondering, when the Access Hollywood tape came out 2 days before this debate, did you wrestle with what to say about it?
Well, first of all, we were shocked, and we were, you know, totally surprised that something like that existed and that it had come out. And we did wrestle with it because we wanted to let people see it. We didn't want to get in the way of people being able to draw their own conclusions, but we also, you know, wanted to, you know, reference it because I found it very troubling, both personally and politically.
Do you understand women who voted for Donald Trump as president, even though they heard what he said on the Access? Do you respect women who voted for Donald Trump after the Access Hollywood show?
Here's what I would say about that. I think what happened after that tape, which was wall-to-wall coverage, certainly affected a lot of people. And I think a lot of women were very concerned about that. And I knew that it would be tough to... I won all women, but I lost white women, and I knew that would be tough, but I ended up actually getting more white women's votes than President Obama had in 2012. So this is not just a problem for me, this was a longer-term Democratic nominee problem. So I knew I was gonna have to work hard on it. And when that happened, and the way, really, it was a horrific 2 to 3 day story, and then it sort of dropped, because remember, within an hour of that tape going public,
WikiLeaks
dropped John Podesta's emails. I struggled with that. I thought, why would somebody find what largely I think could be described as boring, anodyne emails more significant than words coming out of Trump's mouth?
Also at that debate, it was the most tense room I've ever been in for the first 30 minutes, certainly, of the debate. You didn't shake hands with each other, and there was the physicality of Donald Trump walking around the stage. I'm just wondering what was going through your mind at that point.
Well, as I write, you know, I prepared for him to try to use his size and his presence to intimidate me. As I was walking out to get on the debate stage.
That's something you had actually practiced.
Yes, I had practiced, and, you know, one of the members of my team said, remember, he's trying to get inside your head. I said, yeah, you think? Because I knew that the best way he could respond, given what that tape showed, was to try to assert, you know, the alpha male, it's just locker room talk stuff. So we practiced that. And I concluded, after practicing it, that I needed to just remain calm and composed, because if I said anything that acknowledged it. I was afraid that it would look like I couldn't take it, that I wasn't, you know, really tough enough, that this guy was looming over me, I should just be able to proceed. That's what I did. In retrospect, in writing the book, I thought, you know, because my head was like running all through the debate, like, this is really discomforting, this is weird. I've debated other people. What he's doing is deliberately meant to throw me off. Maybe I should say something, you know, like, turn around, you're not going to intimidate me, back off, you creep. But I concluded, no, I wanted to remain composed. You know, it was judged.
Was it distracting for you? I mean, did you see him out of, because obviously you weren't looking at him, but did you see him out of the corner of your eye?
Yeah, you could. I mean, you could feel the presence. And, you know, maybe it's a skill that women particularly develop because, you know, we have to be aware of our surroundings. I certainly was aware of him. And you know, I won the debate according to the analysts and all the rest of that. But as I say in the book, I think that what he did and what he tried to do and his insulting me, like calling me a nasty woman in the third debate, all of that played to his base. So both the men and women who were in his base, in the Republican base, they were rationalizing their support for him all the time. It was like, well, yeah, it probably is locker room. Oh my gosh, you know, look, the director of the FBI says she may go to jail. Okay, well, locker room isn't as bad as that. So there was a constant weighing back and forth. And at the end, he got 90% of the Republican vote. I got 90% of the Democratic vote. And it was in part because I think a lot of people who voted for him thought, well, he won't really be like that as president. And besides, we want our tax cuts and we want to make sure that we get a Supreme Court justice. So I think there was heavy rationalization going on in that last month.
You spent a lot of time in the book talking about how much comfort your husband gave you throughout the campaign and,
yes,
and obviously in the last couple of months. You wrote, "I know some people wonder why we're still together, that we must have an arrangement. We do. It's called a marriage. That I helped him become president and then stayed so he could help me become president. No. That we lead completely separate lives and it's just a marriage on paper. Now he's reading over my shoulder in our kitchen with our dogs underfoot." I'm wondering why you felt the need to include that in the book.
You know, I talked about Bill, I talked about Chelsea, and I talked about my mother, and I talked about my friends, because in the book I have a chapter called On Being a Woman in Politics, where I really do try to take on sexism and misogyny. But I also wanted to make it clear, first of all, that putting yourself out there in politics, in public life, can be immensely rewarding. But that's not all that's important in life by any means. And so I wanted to, you know, really, again, kind of pull the curtain back and say, you know, I lost a presidential campaign that I thought I was going to win. It was devastating. But I have so many blessings in my life, starting with my husband and the life we've built together.
You also wrote that during the what you describe as the dark days of your marriage, the two questions you asked yourself was, do I still love him and can I still be in this marriage without becoming unrecognizable to myself? Were those easy questions to answer?
No, they were really hard questions. You know, anybody alive in America at that time knows how difficult that period was. And, you know, I really had to struggle and I had a lot of angst. You know, I had to fall on back on my faith and my family, my friends. But I wasn't going to be making a decision that other people wanted me to make or that public pressure was, you know, coming in on me. I was going to make my decision. And it was based on those two questions and, you know, the life we had built together. And I'm very glad that that's the way I chose to continue my life.
Chelsea Clinton was a surrogate during the campaign. Ivanka Trump was a surrogate for President Trump. If you had won, would Chelsea Clinton have an office in the West Wing? Would she be able to drop in on meetings with congressional leaders?
No, but it wouldn't even cross her mind. You know, she's got a very active life. She's written a couple of great books. And
is it appropriate?
You know, it's up to a president to decide who is or is not welcomed in any meeting. That's up to a president. And I, you know, can only speak for myself and the White Houses I've been in and the work that I've done. And I think there's not enough expertise and experience yet in the White House right now. I think.
Does it concern you that Jared Kushner, I mean, somebody, as you worked as Secretary of State, who worked obviously on Middle East peace, does it concern you that Jared Kushner seems to be the point person on that?
Well, it concerns me that the deep well of experience and expertise that our country has to offer, our foreign service has to offer, that outside experts have to offer, is largely being disregarded. And, you know, if you look at what's happening in North Korea, we need to have an intensive diplomatic effort. That requires people who know the culture, know the history, know the languages that are involved. I don't see that happening. And then you can pick anywhere else in the world and draw the same conclusion. So we are not engaging in statecraft the way we need to. It's not that individuals can't be part of teams who may have different expertise or perspectives. That's fine. But teams need to be led by people who understand the history and how we got to where we are in order to make progress.
In the book, you make no attempt to hide your displeasure about the Electoral College. You say on page 386, you say the godforsaken Electoral College. You mentioned winning the popular vote, obviously, yeah. multiple times yeah. in the book.
Yes,
I do. You think the Electoral College should be abolished?
I said that in 2000, after what happened to the 2000 election with Al Gore. I was elected to the Senate that same year. And if you look at our recent history, we've had several candidates, nominees, who have won the popular vote and lost the Electoral College. What does that say? And it says that an anachronism that was designed for another time no longer works. If we've moved toward one person, one vote, that's how we select winners. I was amused after the French elections when I was listening to an interview with a French electoral expert, and he said, well, unlike your country, the person who wins the most votes wins. So I think it needs to be eliminated. I'd like to see us move beyond it, yes.
You also mentioned in the book that after you realized you'd lost, you thought about all the lock her up chants.
Yes,
and that right. Donald Trump had said it, actually it was at the second debate, Donald Trump said if he was president, you would be in jail. Is that something you seriously worried about?
Well, I knew I had no reason to worry about it, but I...
But worried that he might make that effort.
You can't predict what he might do. That's one of the lessons I think we've seen so far in this presidency. But, you know, like so much else, I just kind of moved beyond that. I got interested in cleaning my closets and, you know, taking long walks in the woods, things that helped me recover from that loss.
Do you think Donald Trump has moved beyond the election? He does talk about you still an awful lot.
Yes, he does talk about me quite a bit. I don't know. I would think he'd have a lot more important things to spend his time on. He's got, crises all around the world to deal with. He's got divisiveness in our country. He's got the terrible events of Charlottesville and so much else going on that I think he should be focused on rather than constantly trying to take pot shots at me or at President Obama. He does that quite often, too.
Just a couple quick other questions. Senator Sanders, obviously, mm-hmm. he has a strong voice now in the Democratic Party. He comes under a lot of criticism from you in the book. What political sin did he commit other than choosing to run against you?
Well, it's not the political sin he committed. It was the failure to move quickly to unify the party and his supporters. And I know a little bit about this.
Because, after it was clear that he
yes,
wasn't going to get
it was clear I was going to be the nominee like in March or April. It was beyond any doubt in June. And in 08, we ran a much closer, tougher primary contest between President Obama and myself. It was really close. And I immediately endorsed him. And I went to work for him. I spent countless hours, Anderson, convincing my supporters who felt equally aggrieved that they had to support Barack Obama. I was still arguing with big rooms of supporters at the Denver convention. I didn't get that same, you know, respect and reciprocity from Senator Sanders or from his supporters. They are still, you know, incredibly divisive. And I'm interested in what he can do to help elect Democrats. He's not a Democrat. He makes that clear. But we need to do everything possible to win the governorships in New Jersey and Virginia this year, and we need to do everything possible to flip the Congress in 2018. He could be helpful if he so chose, and that's what I'm calling on him to do.
Do you think Donald Trump will be a candidate in 2020?
Well, he's already got a committee open. He's raising a lot of money, so I think he thinks he will be, and we'll have to wait and see what happens.
To those who hear you, they, you know, hear interviews you've done, see the book coming out, and think, is this really what the Democratic Party needs? That they need fresh leadership, they need new voices, they need new people entering the arena, and that by you being on the stage in such a public way, it hampers that.
Oh, I don't buy that at all. I think you know, from my perspective, I have a lot of experience and expertise and insight that I'm sharing with the world, and particularly with Democrats. I've got a new organization called Onward Together. I'm supporting young grassroots groups that have sprung up to recruit candidates, train them, run them, fund them. I'm going to be supporting candidates. So I'm maybe out of politics as a candidate, but I am still deeply committed to doing anything I can to make sure that we don't lose ground to this divisive bigotry and bias and prejudice and you know, favoring the wealthy and the well-connected over everybody else that I see as the agenda of this White House.
You know, General Michael Hayden, I have him on my show a lot, and you know, his lifetime in intelligence work. One of the things he talks about is the thin veneer of civilization, and that he is very concerned that it is a very thin veneer, that we think our institutions are so solid, that our democracy is so secure, that nothing can upset it, nothing can wipe away that thin veneer of civilization. Do you worry about that?
I worry about it all the time. I've heard Mike Hayden talk to you about that, and I know he's written about it, and it's a very serious, sober warning. You know, civilization in part is the institutionalization of the rule of law, of minority rights, of a free press, of the kinds of incredible guarantees that we made as a nation from our very founding. Civilization also requires leadership, so that when people start engaging in white supremacy talk and they parade as neo-Nazis and they are in the Ku Klux Klan and they are unbridled on the internet with their racist and sexist and other kinds of insulting comments, we need leadership at the highest levels of our government to say that's not acceptable. Part of what makes us this dynamic, extraordinary country, which I'm very optimistic about long term, is our diversity, is the fact that we've brought people together from all over to be part of the American dream and the American experiment. So our civilization, which has the attributes of the kind of institutional supports and democracy and citizenship and voting being absolutely core to that, has to be defended internally and externally. And I'm just hoping that more people, and particularly more Republicans, will speak up. Because if we begin to see the erosion of the rule of law and the erosion of our voting system and so much else, that's not going to stop by hurting Democrats, for heaven's sakes. That hurts our entire country. It undermines who we are as Americans. So I think that people like Mike Hayden and as many others as possible need to be speaking out and standing up and saying just that.
Secretary Clinton, thanks very much.
Thanks.